Good morning. For Journal Club presentation today, the article selected is Electrical versus Pharmacological Cardioversion for Emergency Department Patients with Acute Atrial Fibrillation, a Partial Factorial Randomized Trial. This study was published in Lancet in February 2020. Moderator for today's discussion is Dr. Chetan. Atrial fibrillation is characterized by disorganized, rapid, and irregular atrial activation with loss of atrial contraction and with an irregular ventricular rate that is determined by the AV nodal conduction. In an untreated patient, typically the ventricular rate also tends to be rapid and variable between 120 and 160. In some patients, it can also exceed 120 beats per minute. An ECG showing atrial fibrillation. In this, we can see absence of P waves and irregular rhythm, and QRS complexes are placed irregularly. Coming to the classification of atrial fibrillation, so it can be classified as paroxysmal, persistent and permanent mainly. So if a AF is terminating spontaneously within 7 days, it is termed as paroxysmal. If it is continuous for more than 7 days, it is called persistent AF. However, if the AF continues for more than 1 year, it is called long standing. And long standing AF, which is refractory to cardioversion, is called permanent AF. According to the introduction of the study, acute atrial fibrillation is the most common arrhythmia requiring medical treatment in the emergency department. Atrial fibrillation is characterized by, as we all know, disorganized atrial electrical depolarization leading to an irregular and rapid heart rate. Acute atrial fibrillation generally refers to symptomatic recent onset episodes, which are either just first detected or recurrent paroxysmal or recurrent persistent episodes when the duration is less than 48 hours and the cardioversion is a safe option for such patients. The two major approaches to emergency department treatment of this arrhythmia are, as we all know, rate control and rhythm control. In rate control, medications are used to reduce the heart rate, but the patient remains in AF at the time of discharge or admission. However, in rhythm control approach, patients are cardioverted back to sinus rhythm with drugs or with DC electrical cardioversion and are usually discharged home within few hours. Although many physicians believe that rhythm control is better for the patient, there are no trials who have compared rhythm control with rate control, and for acute atrial fibrillation, rhythm control in the emergency departments, some physicians prefer to start with drugs and then move to DC cardioversions if necessary. So this strategy is called the drug shock strategy. Other physicians prefer to start immediately with DC cardioversion, which is called shock only strategy. Emergency department physicians are equally divided in their use of these two competing cardioversion strategies. There is also much variation in the DC cardioversion pad placement in the emergency department. Some people like to place it anterior-posterior, and some people like to do it anterior-lateral pad position. So the primary aim of this study was to compare cardioversion to sinus rhythm between the two strategies. So first is attempted pharmacological cardioversion with IV procainamide followed by DC cardioversion if necessary. So this is called the drug shock strategy. And the second was DC cardioversion alone, which is shock only strategy. And the secondary aim of this study was to compare the anterior posterior versus the anterior lateral pad positions in the DC cardioversion. Coming to the methods of the study, in the study design, actually it is a partial factorial study of two protocols which was carried out at 11 academic emergency departments in Canada. The primary protocol was a randomized, blinded, placebo-controlled comparison of attempted pharmacological cardioversion with IV procainamide, which was given at the dose of 15 mg per kg over 30 minutes, followed by electrical cardioversion of up to 3 shocks of each of more than equal to 200 joules if necessary, versus placebo infusion followed by electrical cardioversion. For the subset of the patients who required electrical cardioversion, a secondary and nested randomized open label comparison study was done of the anteroposterior versus anterolateral pad positions. Coming to the inclusion criteria of the study. The study included stable patients presenting with a primary diagnosis of acute AF of at least 3 hour duration, for whom pharmacological or electrical cardioversion was an appropriate option. Also, the patients having clear history of onset of symptoms within the last 48 hours of arrival, or onset within 7 days of arrival with adequate anticoagulation for at least last 4 weeks. That is, if they are on warfarin with INR more than or equal to 2. Or onset within 7 days of arrival with no left atrial thrombus on transesophageal echo. Also, the patients with previous episodes of acute AF or with valvular heart disease, if they were adequately anticoagulated, they were also included. Coming to the exclusion criteria, patients who did not give consent were excluded. Patients having permanent AF were also excluded. Hemodynamically unstable patients requiring immediate cardioversion, including patients with relative hypotension, which is systolic blood pressure of less than 100, also patients with rapid ventricular pre-excitation, acute coronary syndrome, and pulmonary edema were also excluded. Patients whose primary presentation was for another condition, example, pneumonia, pulmonary embolism, sepsis, were also excluded. The patients whose AF reverted spontaneously and the patients who were previously enrolled in the study were also excluded. The electrophysiology cardiologist on the adjudication committee reviewed the initial ECG to verify that the rhythm was in atrial fibrillation. All participants provided written informed consent and the protocol was approved by the Research Ethics Board at each site. Coming to randomization and masking, on-site research personnel determined allocation for each of the two protocols using an online electronic capture system was done. The allocation sequence was computer generated by an independent statistician using a randomly permuted block design. The two groups in protocol 1 allocation was 1:1. Allocation for protocol 2 occurred 30 minutes after the drug infusion for patients who had not been converted to sinus rhythm. Concealment of treatment allocation was assured using the password protected electronic data capture system. Patients and the research as well as emergency department staff were masked to the group assignment. The pre-mixed IV bags of either procainamide or placebo were semi-opaque and only identified by numeric code. Coming to the procedures, treating physicians were encouraged to follow the acute atrial fibrillation management guidelines to ensure standardized assessment, management, and use of anticoagulation along with proper follow-up. Patients allocated to the drug shock group received a continuous infusion of IV procainamide at a dose of 15 mg per kg in 500 ml of normal saline solution given over 30 minutes. The maximum dose was 1500 mg. The infusion was stopped if the patient converted to sinus rhythm before the maximum dose. The infusion was discontinued if the corrected QT interval increased by more than 35% or the QRS interval exceeded 120 milliseconds or if the patient's heart rate dropped below 60 beats per minute. If the patient's systolic BP dropped below 100 mm of mercury, the infusion was interrupted for 15 minutes and an IV bolus of 250 ml of normal saline was administered. If the patient's BP returned to at least 100 mm of mercury systolic, the infusion was resumed. If not, infusion was discontinued. Patients allocated to the shock only group received a similar weight-based infusion of normal saline placebo over 30 minutes. Patients who had not converted to sinus rhythm by 30 minutes after the infusion finished had electrical cardioversion. Patients were allocated to either the anterior-posterior or anterior-lateral pad positions and received up to 3 consecutive biphasic waveform shocks. The first shock was set at 200 joules but could be higher for subsequent shocks. Procedural sedation was provided by a second emergency physician using short-acting drugs as per local protocols. Electrical cardioversion was done with the local site's standard adhesive pads using the same pad position for all three shocks without crossover. This diagram here shows the position of the pads which were used for the cardioversion. Figure A shows anterior-posterior pad position and figure B shows anterior-lateral positioning of the pads. The primary outcome was conversion to and maintenance of sinus rhythm for at least 30 minutes at any time after randomization and up to a point immediately following 3 shocks. Patients who had not converted by the time 3 shocks had been delivered or who had reverted to atrial fibrillation during the 30 minutes following shocks were deemed not to have met the primary outcome criteria. However, spontaneous conversion after random treatment assignment but before study interventions were deemed to have met the primary outcome criteria. Secondary outcomes evaluated during the emergency department visit were cardiac rhythm at disposition, length of stay in the emergency department, and adverse events. Patients were reassessed in person by research personnel at the hospital at 14 days to determine cardiac rhythm by ECG, recurrence of atrial fibrillation, return visits to the emergency department, stroke, and survival. Coming to the statistical analysis, the primary analytical approach for protocol 1 was by intention to treat. A secondary modified intention to treat analysis was also done that excluded patients who converted to sinus rhythm before the study infusion was started. The primary outcome, which was conversion to sinus rhythm, was compared between the drug shock and shock only groups using absolute difference between two proportions with 95% of confidence intervals and statistical significance testing using an X-square test. The secondary outcomes were evaluated according to the data type, binary outcomes with X-square or Fisher's exact test and continuous data by student's t-test. Subgroup analysis were done by calculating absolute differences between two proportions and 95% confidence intervals within subgroups and by using the Breslow day test for homogeneity to determine statistical significance of differences across the subgroups. Subgroup results were presented using forest plots. Fisher's exact test was used to produce p-values for subgroups with fewer than 5 expected events. The comparison of anterior-posterior and anterior-lateral pad positions was done using a modified intention to treat approach, excluding patients who did not receive electrical cardioversion. The Cochrane-Mantel-Hensel procedure was used to test the difference between the pad positions, controlling for the allocation of the patient in protocol 1. A total sample size of 396 evaluated patients with atrial fibrillation was required using the unpooled set test with continuity correction at a significance level of 5%. Statistical analysis was done using SAS software version 9.4. Coming to the results of the study, patients were enrolled at 11 different emergency departments from July 2013 to October 2018. Of 1,188 eligible patients, 582 did not want to participate, and 210 were not approached, and 396 patients totally were enrolled. None of the patients were lost to follow-up for the primary outcome. Patients in the drug shock group, which was 204, and shock-only group, which was 192 patients, were well-balanced for demographics, clinical characteristics, and investigation results. The mean age of patients was 60 years, and 66 patients were men. The patients presented with a mean of 10 hours from onset. 68% of patients, which is 270 patients, had previous episodes of atrial fibrillation, and the initial mean ECG heart rate was 119 beats per minute. These are the characteristics at baseline of all the patients in the two groups. As we can see in this, the characteristics based on demographic details and presenting symptoms, vital signs, CHADS criteria, medical history, medications, investigations, and other miscellaneous things, everything was compared. However, there was no significant difference in any of the categories among the both groups. Conversion to sinus rhythm occurred in 196, which is 96% of the patients in the drug shock group, compared with 92% in the shock only group. Median time to conversion from the start of the infusion in the drug shock was 23 minutes. 18 patients did not receive the study intervention, primarily because spontaneous of conversion, and these patients were removed from the secondary analysis. In the secondary analysis, proportion of patients with conversion to sinus rhythm in the drug shock group was 97%, which is 192 patients, versus 92% patients in the shock only group. The p-value was 0.04. Almost all patients were discharged home, 97% in the drug shock group and 95% in the shock only group. Similar number of patients converted to sinus rhythm in both pad position groups, which is 94% patients in the anterolateral group and 92% of the patients in the anteroposterior group. The median number of shocks required in each group was 1. Adverse events during the infusion were more common in the drug shock group, but most of the events were transient hypotension during the infusion. Electrical cardioversion was associated with adverse events in 9% of the patients, and one patient in the shock only group had a cardiac arrest when the electrical cardioversion was done without appropriate synchronization, although the patient survived. Overall, no patients in either group died in the emergency department or had a subsequent stroke. Patients were followed up for 14 days with similar outcomes in both the groups. No strokes occurred and only one death occurred, which was due to cancer and not related to AF. Out of the 396 patients, 306 patients, which is 77% of patients, returned for an ECG on day 14, and out of them 95% were in sinus rhythm. Within 14 days after treatment, 42 patients, which is 11 patients, returned to the emergency department because of recurrence of AF. Subgroup analysis revealed that in the drug shock group, a significantly higher proportion of patients presenting with the first episode of AF converted to sinus rhythm than the patients who had had a previous episode of AF. It was also noted that in the drug shock group, a significantly higher proportion of patients younger than 70 years of age converted to sinus rhythm as compared to the patients who are 70 years or older. So this flowchart here summarizes the results of this study. 11,000 patients were screened, out of which 396 patients were enrolled to protocol 1 and randomly assigned to both the groups. 204 patients were assigned to the drug shock group, out of which 99 patients had protocol 1 successful. In the shock only group, 192 patients were assigned, out of which 11 patients had protocol 1 successful. So 91% patients from the first group and 168 patients from the second group were enrolled for protocol 2. So out of these 91 patients, 45 patients received anterolateral pad position and 46 received anteroposterior pad position, out of which total of 42 were cardioverted in the anterolateral group and 37 were cardioverted in the anteroposterior group. On this side, out of the 168 enrolled in protocol 2, 86 were assigned to anterolateral and 82 were assigned to anteroposterior, out of which finally around 77 patients were cardioverted in the anterolateral group and 71 were cardioverted in the anteroposterior group. Coming to the discussion of this study, this large randomized blinded clinical trial found no significant difference between the strategy of attempting chemical cardioversion first and a strategy of proceeding directly to electrical cardioversion for patients with acute AF in the emergency department. Both the drug shock and shock only strategies were highly effective in safely and quickly returning patients to normal sinus rhythm. Almost all patients were discharged home from the emergency department, usually within a few hours of cardioversion, and thus avoided the need to return to the hospital for follow-up. Procainamide converted half the patients in a median time of 23 minutes, thereby preventing the need for sedation and electrical cardioversion. The drug shock strategy was found to be more effective for patients with the first episode of atrial fibrillation and for patients younger than 70 years than it was for the other patients. Although the drug shock group had more adverse effects, most were transient hypotension and none were serious. After 14 days, no patient had a stroke. One patient died because of an unrelated condition and 95% were still in sinus rhythm. Repeated presentations to the emergency department or hospital admissions were uncommon. Although both drug shock and shock only approaches were highly effective and safe, the article authors believe that initial rhythm control with procainamide has the advantage of avoiding resource-intensive procedural sedation required for electrical cardioversion. The most important finding from this study is that either approach to immediate rhythm control in the emergency department leads to a very high proportion of patients being discharged in sinus rhythm without serious adverse events. Patients can be rapidly cardioverted in the emergency department, resolving their acute symptoms and enabling discharge home. This avoids unnecessary hospital admission or next day reevaluation by cardiologists. This obviates the need for anticoagulation in low risk patients or the need for medication prescription for heart rate control. Authors believe that the drug shock approach has an important advantage over the shock only approach. A procainamide infusion leads to rapid conversion in more than 50% of the patients. Regarding pad placement for electrical cardioversion, both the anterolateral and anteroposterior positions were found to be highly effective. Coming to the limitations of the study, many eligible patients were missed because research staff could not always be present during off hours. IV procainamide was chosen because this is the most commonly drug used for acute atrial fibrillation in Canada, and because some European preparations were not available in Canada, example flecainide and propafenone, which many other countries use more commonly. Many patients refused participation, most often because they had a strong preference for either pharmacological or electrical cardioversion. Coming to the conclusion of the study, both the drug shock and shock only strategies were highly effective, rapid and safe in restoring sinus rhythm for patients in the emergency department with acute AF, avoiding the need for return to hospital. The drug infusion worked for about half of the patients and avoided the resource-intensive procedural sedation required for electrical cardioversion. No significant difference was found between the anterolateral and anteroposterior pad positions for electrical cardioversion. Immediate rhythm control for patients in the emergency department with acute AF leads to
excellent outcomes. Thank you.